More on the agenda of the Philippine delegation to COP26. We're now joined by Sarah Jane Ahmed. She's finance advisor to the Secretariat of the Vulnerable Group of 20 Ministers of Finance. Sarah, nice to see you, or nice to hear from you again. Thanks for joining us today. It's very early there in Glasgow. We really appreciate you coming to the program.
Thanks for having me again.
All right. You know, many have said, Sarah, that this is the last chance the world has to rein in runaway greenhouse gas emissions. Simply put, it's the world's last best hope. And climate finance will play a big role, as that report just mentioned, for vulnerable nations like the Philippines. I want to talk to you now about the Philippine agenda there at COP26. Is it strong enough? What do you think about that?
The focus on climate finance is certainly important, and this is strong, and it's great to see that the Department of Finance is in full force there.
Is the Philippine agenda, though, strong enough, or is there room for more things that the Philippines can ask for from these developed nations?
Absolutely. The two items that could be asked for is, one is the failure of climate finance to finance adaptation, and the unaffordability of climate smart insurance and other disaster risk financing tools has translated to loss and damage. So for as long as there's no balanced support for adaptation and resilience, loss and damage is a main issue. And this is where, coming out of the COP, COP26 must mandate the work to explore concrete financing options for loss and damage.
All right. But is the Philippines ready for climate finance? I know that the Philippine delegation there can ask whatever it needs to ask, right, from these developed countries. But back here at home, what do you think about the readiness in terms of policies and programs to welcome whatever takeaway the Philippine delegation may have from COP26? Is the Philippines ready for climate financing?
I think there's certainly room for improvement on both sides, both on the absorption as well as the delivery of climate finance from developed countries. One point of improvement could be to the People's Survival Fund, for example. If that could also be complemented and supplemented by climate finance, international climate finance, and then deployed more rapidly and at scale, that would be a point of improvement.
Mm-hmm. Any other ideas regarding that front, Sarah?
I think the other point, just on the policy front, is there is now a need to really price carbon globally, because this is a negative externality that remains unaccounted for. The Philippines, other developing countries as well, have forests, oceans, and these carbon sinks. And so it's high time to actually price these assets, as well as the externalities coming out of fossil fuel plants with their carbon emissions. So attracting this carbon financing is another opportunity that is yet to be taken into consideration in the climate finance architecture and the entire architecture that we have in the Philippines.
Yeah, well, when we talk about the climate finance architecture, we need only to look at the People's Survival Fund as sort of as a case study in terms of the Philippines' readiness. What do you think, or what made the PSF sort of dead in the water as we speak, and how can we breathe life into it once again? And not a lot of people are actually aware of the PSF.
Right. I think it was a lot of administrative constraints that may have caused a lot of delay. I think one of the learnings is that there is good processes in place on the municipality level. There's already good transfers from national to subnational, and so perhaps to complement those existing channels with climate finance may be a more impactful way of delivering climate finance, rather than maybe through committees, but already have that as part of the budget, considering that I recall former President Nasheed from the Maldives had said developing countries are paying 20% of their public finances to adaptation, and then another 30% to debt repayment. So, you know, I think this is a similar situation in municipalities and cities in the Philippines where they're already paying for climate in some way or form, either losses and damages or perhaps adaptive measures. And so if we could find ways to complement those efforts, that would be ideal, even beyond the People's Survival Fund with existing ways to transfer resources to them.
The key there as well is to have local chief executives who actually want these adaptation and mitigation measures, who are actually learned enough to make sure that their cities and municipalities are climate proof. What can you say about local chief executives who haven't really embraced the whole idea of climate mitigation and adaptation as a way to climate proof their cities or municipalities, Sarah?
Failure to climate proof one city or one's company will just translate into losses. We've already seen it this decade. We have reports that climate change impacts are accelerating. And so what ends up happening is there are these shocks, these non-financial shocks that they end up having to pay for, meaning higher food prices, disruption, unaccounted for. And so this isn't something that we can actually brush off. This is something we have to figure this year, this decade. We can't begin in 2040 or 2050.
Which brings us to the next topic as to how important really it's going to be for the next administration and for all the candidates who are seeking election in 2022 to put this in their agenda as well.
They must. The Philippines is one of the most climate vulnerable countries in the world. On top of that, it also has one of the best, actually, disaster risk financing plans in the world that needs resources. And so this must definitely be at the forefront of the agenda, both adaptation, resilience, as well as the low carbon transition, just because we've had so much volatility in fossil fuels for the last few months. It's been very expensive, and clearly we need price stability and better domestic renewable energy resources, or in terms of using it, as well as taking advantage of all the job opportunities coming out of this crisis.
Well, Finance Secretary Carlos Dominguez, as the report mentioned a while ago, will be presenting his climate finance roadmap. But what do you think, what would make these developed countries listen this time around and actually heed the call of vulnerable nations like the Philippines this time around? I mean, Sarah, you've been talking about this for quite a long time already.
Yeah, so I think something that COVID actually had brought to the table, and the realization, is that we are so interconnected in terms of trade and in terms of supply chains. And so climate finance is not actually a handout. It's the starting point to ensuring that we have not just global financial stability, but stability in our supply chains and trade. And I think that's an important point to keep pushing there, because this is what's going to get the finance flowing. And the $100 billion per year is really just the floor. It's trillions certainly that's needed, but again, the trillions of investment opportunity and trillions to ensure that we maintain global financial stability. As well as, you know, reduce the physical shocks of climate change that'll certainly that already actually is also impacting the developed world. Climate change came knocking at their doors this year.
And again, as you correctly pointed out a while ago, this is something that you cannot really brush off and set aside anymore. Sarah, you've been working as a finance advisor for the Vulnerable Group of 20. A lot of things going into COP26, a lot of frustration as well. and still you remain committed. What keeps your optimism up there? Why is that why does that optimism remain even at this point wherein many have said that it's a minute to midnight? Sarah.
Well, from two climate vulnerable countries, Bangladesh and the Philippines, we don't have a choice. The 1.5 degree Celsius threshold of the Paris Agreement is our point of survival. But at the same time, as a financial analyst, you run the math, you run the numbers, the socioeconomic outcomes of this transition is much larger than business as usual. And so there's so much to gain from this transition. And so I think hopefully economic logic prevails, but at the same time, it's much like COVID, where we all have to do our part. It only takes one country to infect the rest. And the other point is that there is a lack of delivery. It has undermined confidence in the international climate cooperation. The failure right now is a complete break of trust that we've given to powerful countries. And I think that this is something that they would look to rectify this COP. So I am more positive in that sense, because considering the crisis, we need solidarity at this point to survive this.
All right, Sarah Jane Ahmed, Finance Advisor to the Vulnerable 20 Group of Ministers of Finance. Thank you so much for joining us today from Glasgow. Good morning to you. Maybe you can go back to sleep. Thanks a lot, Sarah.
Certainly will. Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.